So this whole week we've been talking about Holy Week. And every day we've talked about a different representation of what that day means leading up to the resurrection of Jesus Christ, Easter Sunday. And so today being Friday, it's known throughout the world as Good Friday. Now growing up, that always was confusing to me because I began to understand what actually happened on Good Friday. For those of you who may not know, Good Friday among Christians is a day that we celebrate, quote unquote, the death and crucifixion of Jesus Christ. On this day, Jesus Christ was beaten, bruised, bloodied, stripped of his clothes, and made to walk with his cross up Calvary Hill, where he was then crucified for hours until his eventual death. That's Good Friday. And most of us would ask again, what's good about that? As I was thinking about that, the Lord reminded me of Genesis chapter 1. I just want to read a few verses to you. In Genesis chapter 1, we get the story of creation, how God created the world, and every day he created a portion of the world. And I want you to notice something in Genesis chapter 1. I'm going to hop around a little bit, but verse 3 through 4. Then God said, "Let there be light," and there was light. And God saw that the light was good. Then he separated light from the darkness. And then in verse 9 through 10, then God said, "Let the waters beneath the sky flow together into one place so dry ground may appear." And that is what happened. God called the dry ground land and the waters seas, and God saw that it was good. Verse 12, the land produced vegetation, all sorts of seed-bearing plants and trees with seed-bearing fruit. Their seeds produced plants and the trees the same kind. God saw that it was good. Genesis 17 through 18, God set these lights in the sky to the earth and governed the day and the night and to separate the light from the darkness. And God saw that it was good. Genesis 1 verse 20 through 21. Then God said, "Let the waters swarm with fish and other life. Let the skies be filled with birds of every kind." So God created sea creatures and every living thing that scurries and swarms in the water and every sort of bird, each producing offspring of the same kind. And guess what? God saw that it was good. And then in verse 25, God made all sorts of wild animals, livestock, and small animals, each able to produce offspring of the same kind. God saw that it was good. Every day, God began a work, and when he finished that work, he said that it was good. And he does this over and over again throughout the 7 days, even to the point where he finishes creating all of it. And I want you to notice something. Just after he creates man and woman, notice what it says in verse 31. Then God looked over all he had made, and he saw that it was very good. And evening passed, and morning came, marking the sixth day. I thought that was so interesting because God is telling us, man, the world was good, but when I made you, the world became very good. And that's such a powerful statement that God makes, that you are the very thing that makes this whole world very good. And then sin enters into the world over the next couple of chapters of Genesis. And you see that very thing, that very good being threatened and attempting to rip us away from God. Because the Bible is clear that sin is what separates us from our relationship with God. Because God is a holy God, he can't be within sin. And there's a price to pay for sin in order to cleanse, in order to wipe away the sin of our life. Blood has to be shed. And yet the reality of our sin and the reality even of throughout the entire Old Testament is that there is no real atonement that you and I can make that can make up for all the sin of humanity until Jesus comes into the world. See, because you and I are flawed, because you and I are sinful, we can't totally atone for our sin. And yet Jesus Christ, being fully man and fully God, lived the life on this earth free from sin, pure in every aspect of himself, and then gave his life willingly as a sacrifice for your sin and for mine, so that we can experience not just salvation, but a relationship with God himself. So why is it Good Friday? Because it was on that day that Jesus finished the work of the cross and allowed the atonement of your and my life to be made complete. As a matter of fact, I want you to notice this. In John chapter 19, verse 28 through 30, Jesus knew that his mission was now finished. And to fulfill scripture, he said, "I am thirsty." A jar of sour wine was sitting there, so they soaked a sponge on it and put a hyssop branch and held it up to his lips. When Jesus tasted it, he said, "It is finished." Then he bowed his head and gave up his spirit. You know, I think a lot of times, especially within the church, we put a lot of emphasis on Easter, and rightfully so. It's a time of celebration. We celebrate the resurrection of our Lord. We celebrate the fact that Jesus is not dead in the tomb anymore, that he is alive, he is risen, he is with us, and that is amazing. But I want you to notice, he said it is finished on Good Friday, not on Easter Sunday. The work of the cross was made complete with his death. He just showed off with his resurrection. It's almost like you owe this major mortgage that you cannot pay on your home, and suddenly Jesus shows up to the bank, not only pays off your mortgage, and then says, you know what? 3 days later, I'm going to come back, and I'm going to buy the bank, and then I'm going to bulldoze the bank. But your mortgage was paid off the day he did it. In the same way, the work of the cross was made complete over 2,000 years ago on Good Friday. Now, we don't know if it was actually a Friday, but this is the day that we celebrate it, because now we know you and I don't have to do anything to earn our salvation. That's impossible. You and I don't have to do anything to make ourselves saved. That's impossible. The impossible was made possible on Good Friday when Jesus Christ willingly gave his life so that you and I, with our faith in the Lord, all we have to do is accept that free gift of salvation. And his worst day became our greatest life. We get this because a good God spent a good day doing a good thing for very bad people. And I'm so grateful that my Lord loved me enough that he was willing to sacrifice his one and only son so that all who would believe would not perish but have eternal life. So I want to encourage you on this very Good Friday to take time and appreciate the Lord and to ask yourself, am I living a life worthy of the sacrifice that was made for me to have it? Now, I'm not saying that to earn it or to, you know, make up for it. Again, it's a free gift. But if somebody gives me something that impactful, I want to make sure that I live up to it. I want to make sure that I represent it well. I want to make sure that I live in a manner that is worthy of the gospel, that is worthy of his worst day becoming my best life. And so with that, church, remember, this is a good day because it is a day to be reminded of the sacrifice that Jesus Christ made on the cross so that you and I can experience the resurrection life. God bless you, love you, reflect and remember who God is today. Have a good one.